Hi, welcome to .NETX YouTube channel and welcome to my course React Interview Question and Answer. My name is Shailen Chauhan. I am Microsoft MVP, Technical Consultant and Corporate Trainer. So in this course, I prepared the commonly asked interview question answer on React.js. So you will learn here the interview question answer about React CLI. You will learn here the interview question answer about React Building Blocks. You will learn about the interview question answer about data binding in React.js. You will learn about the interview question answer about React components. So I prepared the interview question answer regarding these topics. I hope these interview question answer you will find helpful whenever you are going for your next job interview on React.js. And if you are coming to this channel first time, I request you to please do subscribe to .NETX YouTube channel and click the bell icon so that whenever we will upload such video content, you will get notified automatically. So I hope you will join me in this journey to prepare you for your next job interview on React.js. So let's get started. Question answer about the React CLI. So what is React CLI? So React CLI is a tool to configure the necessary configuration for building a React application. Even it helps us to create, build and run the React application. For example, you are going to set up the Babel to transpile the JSX into the browser. And you need to configure the webpack to bundle your project assets. It's a difficult, it's a tedious things when you're doing it manually. But the React CLI is going to do it ourselves. So we don't need to worry about to configure the Babel as a JSX transpiler, which is used by the React.js to convert the JSX code in the plain JavaScript. We don't need to configure the explicitly webpack, which is going to help us to create the JavaScript bundle file, to create the CSS bundle file, so that we can render the things easily. So these things are taken care by the React CLI. So React CLI is a great tool to get started with the React.js, and you don't need to worry about to configure the Babel. You don't need to worry about to configure the webpack for bundling your project. So to get started with the React.js, make sure you have installed the Create React App CLI from the npmjs.com, and then you can get started. The next question is here, how can configure the React CLI? So React CLI need the minimum Node.js version 6.0, and make sure in the on your local machine you are having the npm greater than equal to 5.0. So depending upon the Node.js version you are having local machine, this version is going to be decided. So now we having the Node 14, even Node 16 as well. So Node 6 is very older version of Node.js. So make sure you are having the at least Node.js 6 in a local machine to download the React CLI. And when we are going to install the React CLI, we install it as a globally so that it is accessible on our entire machine. So from anywhere we can able to create the React.js application, we able to build the React.js application. So this is the command you need to run here in the command prompt, npm install create React app, then --dash global. So global means it's a machine level. Then you can create the React project by running this command create React app, then your project name. So this is my project name and this is the CLI. Then go inside the project my app. Then you have to just run this command npm start to run your React.js application. And after running this command, you will get the React default templates index file. So this is the way how we can configure the React.js CLI and how we can create the React.js application and how we can run it. Now the next question is here, how we should define the React application folder structure. So by default, when you will create your React.js application using the React CLI, you will have the folder structure like this way. Let's say this is my app. Then I will have the node modules folder. I will have a readme file. Then I have a packet.json file. I will have a public folder. There we have the index.html and the favicon.icon. In the src, I'm having the app.css, app.js, app.test file, index.css, index.js and the logo.svg. It's a default structure which is going to create it by the React CLI when you will create your React.js application. But later on, how we need to manage our React.js application building blocks. So I'm just sharing here a folder structure which you can follow for designing your React application structure. So you can create a actions folder. In the action folder, you can keep what are the action you're going to follow in your React.js application, because what happens when we are using the React.js, you might be using are the redux, and there you might be creating some action so that it can be created. Then we always create the reusable component react.js. So what are the reusable component? We keep in the component folder. So you can create a component folder here like this way. Then we having the web pages. So what are the web pages you are having? Those web pages we can keep in the containers. So we take them as a containers. Then we having the study content. So for the study content, we can use our images folder. We having the style sheet. We can keep in the style sheet folder here. We can have the utilities. So utilities we can keep in the util. So utilities just like we having an object. Let's say you might be having a utility for date time conversion. You might having a utility for currency conversion. So such thing we can add as a utility. Then we can have the services folder. In the services folder, you can add the services for accessing the data from the database or for sharing your business logic. And finally, we having the index.js file. So this is a typical React.js folder structure you should follow whenever you are working on a React application. And there is no such rule. You have to arrange your application like this way. As per your requirement, as per your easiness, you can manage it. But this is the way how you can manage the things easily. That's why I shared this picture with you. The next question is here, what is the role of package.json file in React.js? So when it is coming to any Node.js application, so Node.js use a package.json file for managing the npm packages. So it is a node package manager configuration file, which include the information about application package dependencies for development and the production. If you're looking at in this picture, this is the screenshot of the package.json file, where I'm having the script section, where I'm having the dependency section, where I'm having the dev dependency section. So the dependencies option include the necessary packages for the production deployment, like we having the React package, we having the React DOM package, you might have the Bootstrap package. So these are the necessary packages we need to run our React.js application on the production machine. Similar way, we having the dev dependencies package, which are required only till development machine. So whenever you are writing the unit test cases, so we need the Jest package, we need the React.js testing library package. So this is required for the development machine, but these are required for the production machine over there. Apart from these two sections, we having a very important section, that is script. This script section is helping us to create the build of our application, to run our application. So this is the command is available here. React.scripts start, React.script build. We having the script for testing purpose. We have the script for the injection purpose. So these things are written in the package.json file. So package.json file is a file which is helping us to manage the React application packages, and which is helping us to store on the script to build and start our application. The next question is, what is the role of package.log.json file? So what happens, what are the package we have installed today in our application for the React.js? After 2 years, after 3 years, we might going to set up the same application from scratch. So make sure we will have whatever the React.js version today we are using. So it must have, let's say, React 17, not the React 19, let's say React 20. It might happen after 2 years and 3 years, you having the React 19 and 20 version as well. So in that case, how we can ensure it? So for that purpose, we having the package log file, which is going to log the dependency for application to a specific version. If you're looking at today, we are using the React.js 17.0 version, and we are using the React refresh this version. So the same version would be downloaded after 2 years and 3 years as well. Let's say 5 years also, if we are not willing to upgrade to the latest version. So how it can be done, like how it can be managed? It can be managed with the help of package log file. So this log file containing the exact version of React.js, which is going to allow to reinstall them if you will configure the same application later on. But when it is coming the package.json, because you might be thinking, what is the difference between package.json? So package.json file is containing the minimum version of that library and that package available that moment, but this is containing the exact version. So if you don't have the package log file, so what will happen after 2 years and 3 years? So if you don't have the package log file, so what will happen after 2 years and 3 years, it will happen. It might downloaded the latest version of React.js. It might downloaded a package, that version that might not be compatible with the older version of library. So that's why we must have the package log file at the application level, so that anytime when you will configure it, you will have exactly the same packages and the same setting which you did 2 years back, let's say 5 years back. The next question is, what is a React and React DOM library? So when you will create your React application, you will find out two libraries over there, React and React DOM. So React is a core library for building the reusable UI components using the JavaScript and the JSX. And we having the React DOM library, which is going to design especially for the browser, because the React.js you can use for the mobile application as well. So initially when the React.js has been introduced, we don't have the React DOM. Everything is the part of the React library itself. But when the React are designed for the mobile application as well, so they just separated the mobile things into the React Native and the browser things into the React DOM. So React DOM is available as a separate package from the React.js version 0.14. Before the 0.14 version, the React DOM package was not available. The everything whatever you are having the React DOM was the part of the React. So when you are building the website, use React and React DOM. When you are building the mobile application, use React and React Native. Question asks about the React building blocks. So what are the React building blocks? So when you are going to build any React application, you will find out the various things over there. So we having the JSX where we write our React.js code, or you can say it is a way to design the template where we are integrating the JavaScript code along with the HTML markup. We need the transpiler so that we can convert the JSX code into plain JS, because browser can understand only JavaScript. We having a virtual DOM because we don't directly work on the real DOM. We first update the virtual DOM, or you can say whatever the changes you are doing in the React.js, those happens first in the virtual DOM, then it's update the real DOM. We having the component for creating the reusable UI component, or you can say for creating the section of a web page. We having the props whenever there is a requirement for passing the data from parent to child. We having the state for maintaining the state at the component level. We having the refs if you are willing to manipulate the HTML element behavior, so we can use refs over there. And here we having a unidirectional data flow. So as a data binding, we don't have the two-way data binding concept over there. We having the unidirectional data flow. We having the event so that we can bind the event over there. We having the component lifecycle hooks. So what are the how the component is going to initialize, that is coming to the component lifecycle. We having the router, like how we can define the routing in the application. We having the forms for creating the forms, and we having the hooks also. So whenever you are going to create the React function as stateful, so there we can use the hooks available in React.js. So these are the main building blocks we having the React.js application. Apart from these, we having the others as well. So depending upon your requirement, you can use them. The next question is, what is the JSX? So JSX stands for the JavaScript XML. So JSX is a mix of HTML and the JavaScript code, because ultimate goal here, we need to integrate the JavaScript code inside the HTML markup, so that whatever the data we are storing in the JavaScript, it will start injecting in the HTML markup. So this is the way how we can use the JSX syntax. It is looking like to the syntax we having the XML. Because in the XML we having the opening tag, we having the closing tag. Similar way in the JSX also, you must have the opening tag and closing tag. If you don't have the closing tag, it should have the self closing tag. This is the self closing tag. And this is the way how I can integrate my JavaScript expression. So using the curly braces, I'm just injecting it. And this is the way how I'm just injecting my CSS class. So I'm using here the class name. It's a React.js syntax, React.js JSX syntax to define the CSS class. Because when it is coming to the ES6, in the ES6 class is a keyword. So I cannot use the class for defining my CSS classes. I need to use class name in the React.js to define the CSS classes. So in the JSX, we use the braces to render the variable, to render the expression, what are the mathematical expression you are willing to mention over there. So when it is coming to the JSX, so JSX is a pre-processor step that we add, that add the XML syntax to the JavaScript, because HTML is not case sensitive, and in the HTML we don't have the XML like things if we are using the simple HTML one. So to add that one, we can use the JSX over there. So JSX help us to create a virtual DOM by returning HTML, and the JSX is faster because of its performance optimization during the compilation, and JSX is time save as well, because ultimately when we are doing the element, if let's say we forget to close an element, so it will let us know, and what are the other errors you are doing by putting your expression, it will let us know. So JS is completely typeset at the compile time, it let us know the errors at the markup and the JSX code we are doing over there. So when you are going to build your React.js application, we use JSX, and these are the benefit because of we prefer the JSX, not only JS. The next question is here, what are the JSX transpiler? So ultimately the JSX code cannot be understood by the browser. We need to change it. We need to transpile it. So for that purpose, we having the transpiler. So initially when you will get started, we write the code in the ES6, we write the code in JSX. Then we having a transpiler webpack, we having here Babel. So these two transpilers are needed to convert our JSX and the JavaScript code into the ES5, or you can say into that JS code which is understood by the maximum browser available in the world. So we targeting here ES5. Then this ES5 is going to be rendered across the world into the different browser. So like we having the Chrome, Edge, Safari, Firefox, Opera, and various other browser. So the transpiler is going to help us to convert our JavaScript and the JSX code into the ES5, equivalent into the plain JS, which is going to be rendered in the browser, so that we will get the output over there. The next question is, what is the role of Webpack in React? So Webpack is actually the React build process. It is helping us to transpile the JSX to the JavaScript and transforming the CSS file to the CSS if you are using the CSS file, and many other tasks. So Webpack is open source JavaScript based build tool, which is helping us to create the bundles in our application for JavaScript, CSS, and images. And Webpack take the dependencies and the generated dependency graph, which allow us to use a modular approach for the development. So we don't need to worry about which module should come first, which module should come later on when we are building on the React.js application. So this thing is automatically managed by the Webpack, so don't need to worry about. And here the Webpack, you can also explicitly configure by defining your configuration file with the name webpack.config.js. So Webpack is playing a very important role when you're working on a React.js application, let's say any other JavaScript based framework, for bundling and creating the build of your project. The next question is here, what the DOM attributes React support? So React has support all the standard and the attributes available in HTML, all are supported by the React.js. So the React.js follow the camel case convention, just like the DOM API follow. Even usually when we write the code in JavaScript, there also we follow the camel case convention, same followed by the React.js. So here we having a list of attributes which works differently in React.js. The React.js mostly support all the DOM attributes, but few of them the React.js does not support as it is. Let's see what are those. Like in place of class, we use class name. The reason is here, the class is already a keyword in the JavaScript. So that's why in place of class, they use class name. And in place of inner HTML, we use this one, dangerously set inner HTML, because this is not recommended to use when you're going to set it the value. But if you need to set the inner HTML, then use this attribute. We use here HTML4 in place of 4, because sometimes we having a text box, and the text box we are willing to connect to a label. So at the label we mention the 4. So now here we can use HTML4. For the defining the style, we don't define the style as simply as we define in the plain HTML. We always pass the style as a JavaScript object. We never pass the style as a string. If you will pass the style as a string, that it will not work. For the event, we use event handler. So if you're having a on change, on click, any other event, so for that we define the handler for handling it. So these are the things you should keep in the mind when you're working with the React.js. So the maximum thing in the HTML attributes supported by the React.js, but few of them it does not support. So these are the things which you should keep in the mind. The next question is here, what is virtual DOM? So virtual DOM is a JavaScript in-memory representation of the DOM, and it is synced with the real DOM by a React.js library, React DOM. So what are the code we write in the JSX? The JSX code is going to represent it by the React.js with the help of a virtual DOM. So what are the changes we will do in the component? What are the event handling you are doing in the component for doing some manipulation? It update first virtual DOM, and based upon the diff algorithm, it find out the difference in the virtual DOM and the real DOM, so that it only update those nodes in the real DOM where the changes is happening. It's not going to re-render the entire virtual and the entire real DOM. It is going to update only that DOM, that node that is going to be updated recently. So the benefit of virtual DOM is it's making the re-rendering faster, because we are just going to render that section which is going to update. It's not going to re-render the entire web page. So the virtual DOM is optimized for the performance and the memory footprint. And on every change, what happens? The React build a new virtual DOM subtree, and React just behind the scene use the diff algorithm that figure out what are the differences we having the virtual DOM and the real DOM, and it compute the minimal set of DOM mutation and put them in a queue for updating the real DOM over there. Then it having the batch to execute all the updates. If you're looking at in the pictorial representation, I'm having a picture. Let's say this is my virtual DOM, and let's say I just update this component, because I just set here state by calling the set state method. Similarly, I'm just going to update this one. So it's not the case it will re-render the entire page, the entire DOM tree. It will only re-render this component, because it does not have its the child. So that's why it is going to impact only this section. But this component having its own children as well. So it will update its child as well, like this way. So this is the way how faster the update will happen when it is going to happen at this component level. So if there is not virtual DOM, what you need to do, you need to re-render the entire things. That is a time consuming. So this is the benefit of using a virtual DOM. It is going to first update the things into the in-memory, and what are the differences we find out we do in the real DOM. The next question is here, do explain the React app initialization process. How the React.js application is going to initialize, it is very important to understand. So the React.js code, obviously we write in the JSX file, then we having the React.js transformer, or you can say the transpiler we have, that is going to transpile the JSX file code into the JavaScript. Then we having the JavaScript library in the runtime, which is going to help us to render it into the browser. So we having the JSX file, we having the JavaScript library, we all together combining and rendering into the browser. So this is the boundary we having for the browser. This is the browser boundary we have. So in the browser boundary, we having the first thing, what the React.js will do, React.js will create the virtual DOM. So virtual DOM representation is similar to the representation we having in the real DOM, and based upon the virtual DOM, it create the this real DOM. This is a real DOM it's doing over there. This is going to be rendered in the browser native engine. So this virtual DOM is managed by the JavaScript interpreter. So we having the JavaScript interpreter where this virtual DOM is going to be created into the browser memory. But when it is coming to display, for the displaying, we having the browser real DOM, which is going to update based upon the changes we are doing in this virtual DOM. So what are the changes you will do in your component label at the web page label? They first update at the virtual DOM label. Let's say I did some change over here. So this section will update in the real DOM as well. So it will not update the entire DOM tree. It will only update, it start the update from this node, and to the child label start updating. It update here also, it update here also. So this is the way how the React.js application initialization process is working, to initialize it at the browser level and finally showing the output to us. Question answer about the data binding. So first question is here, what is data binding? So data binding is a mechanism to bind the data values to the HTML elements. So this is the way how we can bind the data in React.js. So in the React.js, we use the state for storing the data at the component level. So you can see here we are using here this state property as company. Now here using the simple data binding syntax where I'm using the curly braces, I'm able to bind the value of company inside this paragraph. So this is the way how the React.js is helping us to bind the data with the HTML elements. So React.js support the one way, or you can say the unidirectional data binding. So the example which I shown you here for the company, it is a one way data binding over here. And we always store the state at the component level. So what are the data we are just going to show on the view, we store at the component level, then we access it. And in the React.js, we use the state or props to bind the data values to the HTML elements. And if you are willing to use the two-way data binding, just similar to the Angular, so by default React.js does not support the two-way data binding, but with the help of the event binding here, so you can see we having a on change event, which handler we having here handle change, and here I'm just again resetting the state over there for the name. So what the name I'm just binding to this text box, this name I'm binding to this text box. So this name I'm updating on the event change. So it will behave just like we have in the two-way data binding in Angular, but it's not a two-way data binding React.js because it is a event binding. Because whenever I'm changing my text box value, at the same time it is updating the state, and because of that behavior, it is looking like two-way data binding, but it's a unidirectional one-way data binding. The next question is here, how the React.js handle the events? So when it is coming to the event, so how the React.js handle it? So React.js has a built-in cross-browser event system, and it handles the events with the React elements is similar to the DOM elements. So what are the DOM elements we having, and what are the DOM or the events we have? For those, we need to define the event handler. So when we defining the React event, there we follow the camel case rather than the lowercase. So remember it, we use camel case when we are going to use the HTML DOM element event. But in the pure HTML markup, you can use the small case as well. You can say lower case as well. But here we always use the camel case for defining the event along with the event handler. So for handling the event, we need to create a function. That function we pass as a event handler. So this is the way how we can define our on click event for the button, and this is in camel case, and here I'm just passing my event handler using the this keyword. So using the this keyword we access it. So this dot handle click is my event handler. So whenever you will click on this button, it will show this message alert in the alert box, welcome to this dot state name. So somewhere we having a state name where we have given some name. Let's say I have given my name Shailendra. So whenever I will click on this button, it will display to us. So event we use here in the camel case, then we define the event handler, and whenever the event handler is going to be called, so what are the code you have written over there, it is going to be executed and generate the output to you. So next question is how to define the event handlers. So event handlers we can define by using arrow function and by using the named function. So these are the two way we have a arrow function and the name function. And the benefit of using the arrow function is I don't need to use this over there, but with the name function I need to bind the this by calling the bind method. So I prefer to use the arrow function because in the arrow function I don't need to bind the context of the this with that function. But if you are using the named function, you need to bind the context of the this. So this is the way how the name function can be used as an event handler. But make sure when you're defining the name function as an event handler, so in the component class constructor, you are calling the bind method, and the bind method to bind the context of the this. So that whenever you will use the this, inside this handle change function. So this behave exactly in the same context. It will not start behaving in the different way. Otherwise, what will happen? That this start behaving in the different way. So the thing is here in the JavaScript, the each function, this is going to be decided on the runtime. But if you want to preserve the context of the this, we should use the arrow function. So I prefer personally to use the arrow function, because in the arrow function, the straightforward, you just call the event handler, and this is the arrow operator over there. So using the arrow operator, I'm defining this handle click function. Now using the this, I can access it directly. So this is the preferred style if you are using the ES6. And this is the older one when we use the ES5, because in the ES5, we use the function and name function, and in the name function, we need to expressly bind the this context. The next question is here, how to pass the arguments to the event handler. So when you are calling your event handler, we can pass the argument as well, which are used in the event handler in the function. Also, when you're passing the argument to the event handler, so obviously these are the callback function for calling it. So this is the way how can pass my argument. So whenever you are passing the argument, there we call this event handler as a callback function. So here, this is my event handler, this dot handle param click. In the previous syntax, if you will look at for the event handler, we didn't use this syntax. Even we directly mention it's on click equal to curly bracket, then this dot handle param click. But now I'm calling it as a callback function, because the requirement is here, I need to call the event handler as a function. So if you will not mention this as a callback, because this arrow of function is making this as a callback. So whenever you will click on this button, that time this arrow function is going to called, and this arrow function internally is calling the R handler. But if you will not mention this arrow function, so what will happen at the time of rendering this button, the handle param click function would be called. And that is not the expected behavior from the UI. So expected behavior from the UI is whenever you will click on the button, that time only handle param click method will be called. So in that case, you should wrap it in a callback function, and what are the parameters now you're willing to pass, you can pass it. So this is about the data mining React.js you should know to get started with. Question answer about the React components. So the first question is here, what is component? So component is a building block of a React application. So everything React.js is a component, and each component returns one DOM element. So make sure whenever you are writing the return statement to return something from the other React component, it can be only one element. So or you can see whatever the multiple elements you are willing to return from the component, just wrap them in a one root element, or you can say in one parent element, and that is going to return by the component. And the component also help us to split the UI into the independent reusable pieces, and the each piece is processed by the separately. So you can think about a web page as a collection of various components, and each component is going to process separately. It can fetch the data from the different API. It can fetch data from the different data source depending upon our requirement. And what are the change or update you are doing to a single component? So they can be done independently without affecting the others. So sometimes it happens, what are the change you are doing at one component level, you are not willing to reflect on the others component. So that can also be done with the help of the components in React.js. And here the component are controlled by the props and the states. So the props and state we use in the React.js for passing the data or for storing the data at the component level. The next question is how the components can help you to make the web page. So as I said, a web page can be think about a collection of various components. So if you're looking at a typical web page, how we design it, in the typical web page, let's say this is my web page. So this web page can be think about a container, or you can say root component. And this web page will have a header. This is the header which I can create using the header component. It will have a footer. This one I can define using the footer component, and it will have a section, a content where we are going to display the content, the different content depending upon a requirement. So this one also we can divide into two section again. So this is my the sidebar. So we having the sidebar over there, and this is my the content part. In the content part, we can display here the article component. We can have this component as well. Let's say the comments component. In the right sidebar, we can display the categories. We can display the news feed. So this is the way a web page can be thought of, a combination of multiple components which can be render the content from the different APIs from the different data sources. The next question is, what are the different types of components are available in React.js? So React.js support two types of component, stateful and stateless. So stateful component can be thought as the class based component, and when it is coming the stateless component, these are the functional component. So functional component are the stateless, and the class based component are stateful. So next question is, what are the stateful component? So when it is coming the stateful component, so all class based component in React.js are considered as container, smart and the stateful components. So here in the stateful component, we can use the state for storing something at the component level. So this is the way I've just created a state, and it's going to store the data at the component level. And this is state we can access in the UI label using the this dot state. Then what are the state property we are having? This is the property here coming, which I'm going to access over there. And when it is coming to the defining the stateful component, so stateful component inherits from the state dot component class. You can see this is my component class. This is the component class which is available in the built-in React library, which we are importing over there here. Now I can access. So this component class is the part of this React library we have. So lifecycle hooks can be implemented in the stateful component. So when this component is going to be rendered, so we having the various lifecycle hooks method. So we having the component did mount, component will mount, and various other lifecycle methods which we will discuss in upcoming question and answer. So these methods also going to be used to inject our own custom logic. So when it is coming to initializing the state, so state we always initialize in the stateful component inside the constructor. And when it is coming to update it, we can update it from the others lifecycle hooks method at the component class. The next question is here, what are the stateless components? So all functional components are considered as stateless, are presentational component, reconsider the dumb component we having over there. So in the stateless component, a simple function where we are displaying some static content, or let's say where we passing some content from the parent component, and using the props we are displaying that. So in that place we prefer to create the stateless component. You can say we create the component using the function. So stateless components are the pure JavaScript function. As we having the function in the JavaScript, similar way we having the stateless component. So the pure JavaScript function does not have their own state, because state we only have at the function which are going to be create an object, or you can say the constructor function are going to be used to contain the state. But when it is coming the pure function, they never store any state. So you should use the stateless component whenever the data never need to be changed, or you can say data is coming from the master component, from the parent component, and we need to just display it. So there we prefer to use the functional component. Even the another use case is here, let's say sometime it happens you're just showing some static information. Let's say you having a header image, you having some footer links. So this is a static content. So the static content we can easily render using the stateless component in React.js. The downside you will find out in the stateless component, it is not having the lifecycle hooks method. So as we having the lifecycle hooks method in the stateful component, or you can say the class based component, where we can inject our own custom logic at the time of rendering, at the time of by loading the component UI. But here we don't have the access to those lifecycle hooks method. Whenever you are doing an update, whenever you are going to render it, it is going to be done only in the component function, because here we are just creating a function. So this picture I created the function using the arrow function, but you can also create a normal function as well as we created in the JavaScript.